J-Shrek, Myths, Legends, and Lies. And today we're going to say something I would consider to be on the lies. You know, we stopped in here in a museum in Prescott called the Smoky Museum. And it was like, I've never heard of this tribe. And I was like, really kind of baffled, to be honest with you. And now I know why, because there wasn't anything like this. It was a complete and total farce. Now, it might have been put together originally, you know, for a good, noble cause. You know, they were trying to save the Prescott Rodeo, which is one of the oldest rodeos, you know, in the United States, right? And so they started to perform and dress up as natives. And eventually what happened was it was successful enough that, you know, they actually saved the rodeo. But it seems like maybe they were a little smitten by their success, and so they continued to then portray themselves as natives and actually kind of form their own Rotary Club. You know, it was said that nothing happened in this city of Prescott unless the Smoky tribe was involved. Now, they had prominent people involved like Barry Goldwater. You know, and the story of Barry Goldwater is that, you know, his initiation was he had to run down the main street down here, stark naked, drunk, of course, right? And so what it seemed to be was more of a fraternal order of chaos than anything. And so, you know, it took them forever before they finally submitted to the fact that, you know, what they were doing was not right when it came down to cultural standards that, you know, and what you do, what this exhibit does is it opens your eyes to the fact that, you know, people have taken, you know, whether it be religious freedoms or cultural freedoms or even designs and things like that, that taken liberties and basically lifted, stolen, however you want to put it, you know, from the people that actually designed them. You know, if today you had a design and somebody, you saw it, I mean, you would have some type of, you know, precedent to maybe have some type of lawsuit. And even though if these things came down as maybe innocent, you know, the reality of it was it's not innocent. There's a point where, you know what, I mean, there's a display over here that kind of says it all. And it kind of states that, you know what, if anyone else acted that way, you know, the result would be pretty interesting. So take a look at this and you tell me what you think is appropriate. You know, they were petitioned to change all their stuff numerous times. But the reality of it is, it really didn't change till 1990. So all those years, you know, they portrayed themselves as being something they weren't. And, you know, there's a point where they actually committed or believed in their own minds that what they were doing was just and right. So, yeah. You be the judge of that. J-Shrek, if you get a chance to come up to Prescott and take a look at this exhibit, which changes regularly, the building is absolutely beautiful. So if they did one thing right, was they really got this building is absolutely gorgeous, and the grounds are gorgeous, and everybody here is great. But come over and support, you know, the different cultures, and take a ride up to Prescott. J-Shrek, Myths, Lies, and Legends on the road to mystery.
Hello, my name is Manuel Acero. I am the assistant director here at the Smoke Eye Museum of American Indian Art and Culture. I am from the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma, and myself as am a traditional dancer. I'm one of the many Native people that work here and serve here at the museum since it's taken a new path. It's with non-natives imitating Native American dances. As long as a Native person teaches them and they understand them, then it's okay.
What is your opinion on that?
What's my opinion on it? Well, I'll read it to you. It says, we Natives preserve our own culture
and it's no one else's responsibility. The dances are prayers. Every song is a prayer. Every beat of the drum, every step, every movement is part of that prayer. The principal importance of this prayer is that we are all joined in. The Boy Scouts of America doesn't respect this, because if they did, they wouldn't be imitating our dances. That's my opinion. It's on the wall. And then above that is a quote from the Boy Scouts of America from Order of the Arrow. And then you have phony baloney shamans, the ones that will charge you money to go to Indian ceremonies, and they're not even Indian themselves. The worst one being James Arthur Ray. I mean, with most of these folks, worst thing that happens is you get ripped off and you're out a few hundred bucks. But this guy charged $10,000 a piece to take people to a sweat lodge. He ended up killing three people, and several more went to the hospital. He recently just got out of prison for that, because in 2010 he was arrested. He just got out in 2013. He only did 3 years, so 1 year a piece for each person he killed. And then as of 2016, he was attempting to relaunch his career as a motivational speaker. So this stuff can be dangerous. It literally can hurt you if you don't know what the heck you're doing, like running a sweat lodge. Most medicine men practice or apprentice for 20 years before they're allowed to doctor someone. So to have this yahoo read a book about it and then go stick people in there and cook them to death is what he did. Mm-hmm. He had no business. And so these phony baloney people can do that to you. You folks need to be aware. That was going away, you know, and they had that in their head, that there was, you know, Native people are a vanishing race and that they were preserving Indian culture. Well, when you think about the snake dance, this is a 4-day ceremony, all in all, and they turned it to a 45-minute show. So how much are you really preserving? Just the little cool parts? So, in their heart of hearts, most of them, I'm sure, thought that they were doing something really great. Then I've also talked to some of them that were like, no, I was just there because that's the best way to network, you know, and to be somebody here in town. So, were their hearts in the right place? Some of them claim they were. As a Native person, I'm from the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma. I've been a traditional dancer my whole life. And to hear about this stuff, I'm calling BS. I'm calling BS because, I've seen they claimed that they were very authentic and they researched everything. And I've seen film footage, of one of them doing a tail dance, which is a Southern Plains dance, which I do. And everything was wrong. Their outfits were wrong. The songs were wrong. The drums were wrong. Their dance steps were incorrect. The meaning of the dance is completely gone. There was nothing to it that was correct. But yet they were putting this on us as if they were authentic, and they weren't. I've heard stories too that they've actually had some Native people come in and tell them, you know, how to do things correctly and so on. But from what I've seen, not so much. And the Hopi people are mostly quiet folks, and other Natives know them as the peaceful ones. So when you get Hopi folks, especially elders, out here on the courthouse square holding signs and protesting and saying, don't go see these people, you're not seeing real Indian stuff, don't give them your money, and you've really ticked them off, you know you've done something wrong, because these folks are usually very quiet and they keep to themselves up there on the mesas. Not the case. They were upset. Finally, like I said, 1991, the Smoke Eye people stopped dancing, and they turned the Smoke Eye, all the properties held, including the museum and everything, into a new corporation, the Smoke Eye Museum Incorporated. And that consisted of this property that we're on now and $5,000. And from then, the museum has changed direction. No more mimicking and copying and whatnot. Today it's an institution of education to instill respect and understanding for the indigenous cultures of the Southwest. Today, the Smoke Eye Museum, the board of directors is 70% Native, from tribes from all over the country, as well, including Native Hawaiians, Chumash from California, Potawatomi from Oklahoma, Navajo, Hopi, Lakota, and Yavapai as well. So things have changed here. They've changed direction. No more costumes, no more dances, no more ceremonials. That will never happen again. The real slap in the face to Native people at the time was it wasn't until 1978, with the passage of the American Indian Religious Freedoms Act, was it finally legal for Native people to publicly do their ceremonies and dances and whatnot. So these guys were able to do this during the 20s and all the way to 91 because, simple fact is they were white. And they were able to get away with it. They didn't just copy the Hopi, they were multicultural offenders. The Apache, Santa Clara, Aztecs, Winnebagos, you name it, they copied it. Some of their dances were quite dangerous, and ceremonies were quite dangerous, including this one here, an Aztec dance. One gentleman actually fell off and broke his back. So I believe they stopped doing that particular one after that. But they did the Hopi snake dance, they did hoop dancing. A lot of their costumes were hodgepodge together, because they would use one costume one year for one ceremony and then alternate a little bit and use it for a different ceremony. So you had, let's say, a Sioux war shirt, an Apache necklace, and a Navajo skirt, and so on and so forth. Maybe you have a hoop dancer wearing Ojibwe or Great Lakes people floral designs on their aprons because it was Indian and it was cool. Every one of them wore a wig, of course, just like in Hollywood, and everybody had a headband on, just like in Hollywood. And that was to hold the wig on. It wasn't that, you know, all Indians wore headbands. They also got really into it. They would shave their bodies completely of hair because Native people don't have body hair. Another stereotype. And they got Max Factor of Hollywood involved, who came up with a smoke eye red for them. And you can see here these laboratory scientists at Max Factor are putting together the makeup for them. Of course, they would also, particularly even during the Prohibition, would tie one on. You can see a smoke eye dancer here with a beer in his hand. But if that doesn't look like blackface, I don't know what does.